Amen. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity. This portion of the scripture that we're reading from St. Luke, the 24th chapter, verses 1 through 12. And this is known this morning, as we all know, as Christ's resurrection and ascension. Now, upon the first day of the week, early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. And they entered in, and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid, and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, The Son of Man must be delivered unto the hands of the sinful men, and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words, and returned from the sepulchre, and told all these things unto the 11, and to all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene, and Joanna, and Mary the mother of James, and other women that were with them, which told these things unto the apostles. And their words seemed to them as idle tales, and they believed them not. Then arose Peter, and ran unto the sepulchre, and stooping down, he beheld the linen clothes laid by themselves, and departed, wondering in himself at that which was come to pass. Let us pray. To God, we thank you for being able to be in your house this morning. Those of us who you've saved, dear God, and believe that Jesus is alive and risen, who lives in our hearts today, don't have any doubt about it. But unfortunately, dear God, there are some just like those were in those days that still don't believe and have doubt in their hearts. We're praying this morning that each and every person here today that know you as their personal Savior, as they listen to the message today that the pastor bring, that it would touch their hearts and that they will leave here renewed, dear God, to be able and looking forward to go out and to tell others about our risen Savior. And if there be any here this morning that don't know you as your Savior, that we would pray that they will be convicted in their hearts, dear God, and that they will come run and ask you what they can do to be saved. Heavenly Father, we pray and we ask these things in the name of Jesus, our Savior and our risen Lord. In his precious name we pray. Amen.
Needing strength for my journey, I knelt at the cross where Jesus once died for me. And I asked, is this a place where hope abides? And this he said to me. Find me there anymore, and beyond the
to. Amen. Let's take our Bibles this morning and turn over to Matthew 28, first 15 verses. Matthew 28, if you would please, let's stand for the reading of God's Word this morning. Matthew 28, 1 through 15. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the woman, Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulchre with fear and great joy, and did run to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, All hail. And they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. Then said Jesus unto them, Be not afraid. Go tell my brethren that they go to Galilee, and there shall they see me. Now when they were going, behold, some of the watch came into the city and shewed unto the chief priests all the things that were done. And when they were assembled with the elders and had taken counsel, they gave large money unto the soldiers, saying, Say ye, his disciples came by night and stole him away while we slept. And if this come to the governor's ears, we will persuade him and secure you. So they took the money and did as they were taught. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you now for Jesus. Thank you for his resurrection. Thank you, Father, for what it means. Thank you, Lord. We just pray that today your word would speak. Pray that we would have ears to hear. I pray, Lord, that if there's anyone here that has unconfessed sin in their hearts, I pray they would get it right now. Lord, we don't want any hindrances for the Holy Spirit today. We want to hear from you. And I just pray, Lord, that you would cleanse our hearts. Help us to be attentive, pray for no distraction. And I pray above all, Lord, that you'd be glorified today. Pray that hearts might be changed and brought more in line with your will today. Lord, save the lost if there is anyone here that doesn't know Jesus as Lord and Savior. Please, Lord, bless as you see fit. Help us to be pleasing in your sight. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. So today is the day that we commemorate and celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. With that glorious thought in mind, let's take a little mental journey, if you will, back to that morning. Let's examine the events at the tomb, because they have a lot to tell us as we search to see what happened and what it really means for you and me. First, there are the women that approached the tomb. Now, Matthew records the fact that two women came to the tomb that morning. The other gospel writers say others came as well. They probably arrived in different little groups. However they came, I'm sure that they were very sad. I'm sure they were feeling defeated and discouraged. Some had witnessed and others had heard of the death of Jesus Christ on the cross. And they were coming to pay their last respects to his body there in the tomb. In Matthew 28:1, it talks about, in the beginning of our text, let me just read that again, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn Toward the first day of the week came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. Maybe they came because they wanted to pray or meditate near the place where the body of the Lord was laid. Whatever the reason, we are told that they came to see the sepulcher. Some came as a last labor of love. Mark 16:1 tells us, and when the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome had bought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. Some of the women came to perform one final act of love for the Lord Jesus. They came to finish anointing his body for burial. They just wanted one more time that they could serve him. Some came to just ponder the moment, and just to linger for a while. If you want to turn over to John chapter 20, read a small portion there, verse 11 through 18. But Mary stood without at the sepulchre weeping, and as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the sepulchre, and seeing two angels in white sitting, the one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain, and they said unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? She saith unto them, Because they have taken away my Lord. I know not where they have laid him. And when she had said thus, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing, and knew not that it was Jesus. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, saith unto him, Sir, if thou hast borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus said unto her, Mary. She turned herself, and saith unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master. She saith unto her, or Jesus saith unto her, Touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren, and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord, and that he had spoken these things unto her. These verses tell us something important about Mary. Mary had a very close relationship with Jesus Christ. She stayed at the tomb after the others had already gone. Here we see this woman that owed so much to Jesus. There was a time in her life when she was possessed of seven demons. Her life was radically changed by the Lord. It just reminds me of how radically changed my life became when I asked Jesus Christ to save me. Can you say that yourselves? Do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? He is a radical in the best of senses. He will change you and completely alter your life. You see, she was one of the last at the cross. She was one of the first. She was the first that had seen him after he had risen from the dead. Surely her heart was broken that morning, but still, she wanted to come. She wanted to express her love and worship him. Now, there were some obstacles here. Obstacles to faith, really. And they needed removing. Number one would be the stone, I would say. As we saw earlier in Mark 16:1, it tells that while the women made their way to the tomb and they were planning on preparing the body for burial, they had a concern. They didn't know how they were going to get that stone out of the way. Big old stone. They weren't possibly going to be able to move that thing. The stone represented something, too. It represented a finality in death. The stone represented an exclamation point at the end of the sentence of death. The stone said, he's gone, and he's gone forever. Thank God the Lord took care of that stone. He didn't have to let Jesus out. I believe Jesus was long gone before the angel even arrived on the scene. The stone was rolled away for this reason, so that people could look in and see that the tomb was forever empty. One of the obstacles to faith, the stone, was rolled away. He removed the soldiers as well. Fascinating little thing here. Let's Good. Matthew 27, 62 to 66. Matthew 27, 62 to 66. Now, the next day that followed the day of the preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate, saying, Sir, we remember that that deceiver said, while he was yet alive, After 3 days I will rise again. Command, therefore, that the sepulchre be made sure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away, and say unto the people, He is risen from the dead, so that the last error shall be worse than the first. Pilate said unto them, Ye have a watch, go your way, make it as sure as you can. So they went away and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch. The chief priests and Pharisees were concerned that the prophecies that Jesus had been pronouncing might actually be true. They might actually come to pass. And that scared them, didn't it? It really upset them that just possibly there may be some truth to this man. This reminds us of the importance of Jesus' death on the cross. His death is emphasized there. And it reminds us of the importance of his resurrection as well. You see, to back up a little bit here, the Pharisees were worried, and they wanted the guards to be at the tomb, so they did something a little extra. They put Pilate's seal up on the stone. And when they did, that seal meant something. It was an important aspect of this whole sealing of the tomb. It meant that if they broke it, whoever broke it was going to die. They were sentenced to death. That's just the law. Now, as the detachment of soldiers stood at the obstacle between the saints and their entrance into the tomb of Jesus, an angel shows up. And the soldiers, these brave men, battle-hardened soldiers, fainted. They fell at the feet of the angels. And this second obstacle to faith was removed. The guard at the tomb was rolled away. As the angel began to speak to the women that morning, there was another obstacle, probably the most stubborn obstacle that needed removing. The greatest obstacle of all, unbelief. His message inspired them to belief in the resurrection. I think an angel speaking to me would definitely help my belief. Notice what he reminded them of. He told them a little bit about the past, the present, and then the promise, the future. He reminded them of the crucifixion. His death, Jesus' death, provided the sacrifice that was needed to cleanse sinners from their sins and make them right with God. 1 John 1:7, but if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. The blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth from all sin. Then he reminds them of the present, where they are now. You're here at this tomb right now. Jesus isn't. He is risen. That was probably the greatest proclamation ever to fall on human ears. His death was the perfect eternal payment for sin, but his resurrection was God's receipt for the full amount. When Jesus died on the cross, he said, it is finished. And when he rose from the dead, God the Father said, I am satisfied. He reminds them then of the promise. They're reminded that the resurrection shouldn't have taken them by surprise. This was prophesied. They were told this was going to happen. After all, there are many examples in the Bible about the resurrection. Let me read just a few of them, just from Matthew, starting in 12:40 through 26:31. Matthew 12:40, for as Jonas was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Matthew 16:21, from that time forth began Jesus to shew unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem, suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and be raised again the third day. Matthew 20:19, and shall deliver him to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge and to crucify him. and the third day he shall rise again. Matthew 26:31. Then saith Jesus unto them, and ye shall be offended because of me this night. For it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock shall be scattered abroad. The crucifixion should not have surprised them. This is just four examples of prophecy just in the book of Matthew. This shouldn't have been something that, was that really true? Was that really going to happen? Did they, in fact, believe? They should have been outside the tomb holding a worship service. They had been told this is going to happen. They should have been ready to meet him when he came out of the tomb. I don't want to be too harsh on them. I think I see myself in this. And finally, he reminds them of the proof. The angel's invitation is for them to look into the tomb and see for themselves. See for themselves, Jesus is gone. Later, when Peter and John arrive, John records the fact that the linen clothes that had been wrapped around the body of Christ were laying there, looking like an empty cocoon. The napkin that was on his face was folded neatly by itself. There are a couple of reasons why the appearance and the arrangement of the grave clothes are important. First, there was a sign of no human intervention. If someone had taken the body, they could have removed it, but the grave clothes probably would have gone with it. And so they wouldn't have been left. They'd have been in a hurry, grab the body and run. Or if they had tried to unwrap the body, the grave clothes would have been strewn all over the place. Neither would they have taken time to fold the napkin. The napkin that was over his face would have probably just been discarded on the ground as they ran out. So it suggests something a little bit different, some perfect order. Something had taken place that was not a rushed event, but that was, in fact, the correct way of doing things. It suggests that resurrection took place. Second, there is an ancient Oriental custom concerning the napkin. When a man with servants was eating a meal, he would often use his napkin as a signal to his servants. If the napkin was kind of wadded up and left there, that meant he was done. He wasn't coming back. Now, if the master gets up and folds his napkin and sets it by his plate, that means he's coming back again. Now, when Peter and John arrived at the tomb, they feared the worst. But perhaps, just perhaps, because John, who had been raised with servants, probably knew of this custom, he quickly grasped the whole meaning. He probably got the idea that what Jesus said happened. It finally clicked. He understood that the prophecies were true. Now comes the best part. The Lord appears. In verse 9, the Bible tells us, and as they went to his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, all hail! And they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. As they were going to tell others, Jesus met them in the way. He came and gave them a personal word of encouragement. He said, all hail! All hail. You know, translated roughly, it means, oh joy. I'm really happy to see you. A lot of times we look at Jesus like he really isn't anything. We look at him kind of in a pious way. I think we look at him like, yeah, he's God, but he's not really like us. I think in many ways he's very much like us. That's how he relates to us. When he says, oh joy, I think he really means that. You see, God can't lie. He's not going to put on a front. When he says, oh joy, he is happy to see his disciples. He is thrilled to see them. He came to personally see them so they might know firsthand that indeed he was risen from the dead. And when they meet him, they're so overcome with love and joy, they throw themselves at his feet. I can only imagine that. And I think that would probably be the natural reaction to actually seeing Jesus Christ. I think for me, when I really think about it, I think That's probably where you'll find me on my face before the Lord. Let him lift me up. Let him be the one that rises me up off the ground. They can't help but come into his presence and worship him and praise him. And it's a fact. Those who know the risen Savior want to worship him. When the Lord speaks to these ladies, it's to comfort their hearts and to confirm their mission for the future. He assures them that all is well and that time has passed, that they have to worry about death because, you see, he's alive now. He's going to take care of all that arises in life from here on out. It's glorious news. It's the fulfilling of so many years of waiting. Only a living Lord can give peace and assurance to the hearts of his people. Only a living Lord can be present with them right then as they were in the way. Only a living Lord can speak words of comfort, peace, and hope. A dead Lord can't do that. It's got to be someone who can speak. It's a living God. Thank God for our living Lord this morning. Not everybody that heard all of this wonderful news was happy, though, were they? As we get to the end of our text, we see in the closing verses that the enemies of the cross and of the resurrection were already gathering to try and plot on how to fix this problem, because that's what they had. They had a problem. If Jesus was really alive from the dead, then they had an issue. It meant that he was right, they were wrong. It meant that their system of worship was dead, and that Jesus alone was the path to salvation. They had to find a way to silence the disciples and to counteract what had happened at the garden tomb early that morning. And I would say they were pretty scared. Their whole livelihood was about to evaporate before their eyes if they didn't do something quick. So they devised a plan. His resurrection being the problem that it was, they needed to find a way to discount it. That's what the Jews were doing in these verses. They made a lie and a cover-up plan. They devised a scheme to avoid having to face the facts. They willingly chose darkness over light. And that's what we do every day as people. People hear the claims of the gospel and they turn a deaf ear to it. They try and justify their rejection. There is no God. No, I believe in humanism. I believe in science. If you believe in science, then you would probably see the beautiful natural order of things. But it's just a way of refuting the truth. They're saying no to the only one who can give them life. They're refusing Jesus Christ, the truth, and believing a lie of the devil. And it takes them off into damnation, and it is a foolish plan. In a foolish way to live a life. You see, there was an agreement with the soldiers that if Pilate heard about what they were doing, heard about this lie, that they would get them off the hook with their little perjury. If a Roman soldier was to fall asleep on post, there was another death sentence. There are lots of death sentences going on in these days. There's just another one. If they fell asleep at post, they would be put to death. But notice what was told them. His disciples came by night and stole them away. Now, you got to think about that for a minute. What kind of a condition were the disciples in at the moment? I don't think they were in much of a condition to go after the body of Christ. I think these men were probably cowering in fear somewhere. They were so scared when Jesus was arrested that they all just scattered. They all took off in fear. They were so afraid that only one of them even showed up for the crucifixion. They were so afraid that they allowed the women to go to the tomb and finish preparing the body. I don't think these men would have ever stolen the body. This passage begins with a tale of life, and it ends with a lie. And it really kind of sickens me to think of that. Something as beautiful as the resurrection. The devil just tries to destroy everything that's good and right in this world. He tries to come into your life and tell you the Bible's not real. The Word of God's not true. The devil's a liar and he hates you. Get that point. Just the devil hates you. He wants you to believe a lie. Which has influenced your life the most? Is it the life that Jesus provides? Or is it the lie that was told? The life or the lie? I praise the Lord for the life. It changed my life forever. And if you know Christ as your Savior, it's changed yours too. The events of that day will forever reverberate throughout eternity. Those who come to Jesus by faith will be saved. They'll become partakers of the life of God in Christ. But those who believe the lie will be damned to hell. I don't know if that bothers you. It really bothers me. It bothers me when I think about people I know that don't know Christ, that don't want to know Christ. They say that. Those people need Jesus. We need to be reaching out to people, folks. We need to be in prayer for those people that we know that don't know the Lord. We need to ask God for those divine appointments where we can share the gospel. As I close, I want to just remind us about this first resurrection day. It's not going to be the last resurrection. There's going to be another resurrection. Because he lives, those who place their faith in him will live as well. Those in the graves will come forth one day. Those who are alive when he comes will never taste of death. We'll be caught up in the clouds. We'll meet him in the air. When he died, he tasted death for us. Thank God for that day when death lost the battle with life forever. Thank God for the day the battle was forever won for you and me. Thank God for the first Resurrection Sunday. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for your word today. Thank you for the scriptures that we read, the truth that we read. And I just pray, Father, that if there's someone here that doesn't know Jesus, that they would come today. That once and for all, they would just give up whatever's holding them back. Let go of that chair and come. And I pray, Father, that they would come and ask Jesus to forgive them of their sins, to cleanse their hearts, to come in and be Lord and Savior. So, Father, we do pray that today. And we pray, Father, for those that are even saved, Lord, that maybe just needed to hear this message again, and that they just need to understand that the time is short, and that we need to be sharing Jesus with a lost and dying world. And I pray, Father, if there's someone here that just needs to come, for whatever reason you have laid on their heart, we know that only you know the hearts of man. And I pray, Father, that you would deal with individuals. Whatever the need, I pray that they would come today. So, Lord, we just want to give this time of invitation to you now. Father, we love you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.